Hello, what a lovely place to reminisce, isn't it? I want to tell you about my grandfather. He was a blacksmith in Wareham in Trinity Lane. He died in 1953 at the age of 71. My father was apprenticed under my grandfather. He too was a blacksmith. But my father left and went and worked elsewhere and left the profession. Years later, I remember speaking to my father and saying, "What makes a craftsman?" And my father looked at me and said, "Your grandfather, he was a craftsman." But he said, "I never was." I thought it was an odd thing to say. So I said, "What do you mean, Dad?" He said, "Your grandfather, he worked from dawn to dusk. He enjoyed his job so much. It was a profession. Everything had to be done just right." I'd like to go and meet Alan Brown now, whose great-great-great-grandfather became a hurdler and started the company in the 18th century.
I'm cutting off gads now, ready for spar making. When we cut the wood in the morning and turn it enough, we knock off the bottom of the butt to use for gads for spar making. And these are the gads. Generally nice and straight, no knots in them. And then when the thatcher comes to twist them, they won't break in his hand. Generally about 2 foot six long, so by the end you've finished off with a spar about 2 foot four. And that's what most thatchers seem to want these days.
The wood we use is generally about 7 years old, depending on how quickly it grows. What we do when we're cutting, we've got the cutting hook, and we use an upward stroke to leave a nice clean finish on the mock that's left in the ground. A standard garden hurdle has 9 uprights. The uprights in the middle of the hurdle are always split, and the two on the end are always used in the round and split because they're slightly more substantial like that. Making a hurdle is like weaving. It's literally a case of putting the rod in front of one upright and then behind the next, working your way right the way along, and then start on another piece and doing exactly the opposite. Most of the skill in making a hurdle is involved in actually keeping the shape of the hurdle. So it's 6 foot wide at the top as well as 6 foot wide at the bottom.
I've always wanted to work outside. I didn't want to work in an office or anything like that. My father used to work on the farm, but when I was at school I was lucky enough to be in the careers office, and there was an advert in the careers office for a trainee thatcher, which was locally, he was only 3 miles from where I was living at the time, so I thought, well, yeah, I'll give that a go. And once I started it, I couldn't do anything else, really. This one's going to be an ornamental decorative ridge, and it's going to be about 5 inches thick, mainly of wheat straw, and fixed down with hazel spars. And then it'll all be wired in to keep the birds from ripping it to pieces. Water doesn't penetrate the actual coat work. What it does, it's on an angle of probably no less than 45 degrees, and the water just drips off each individual reed, and when it gets to the actual bottom of the coat work, it drips off then.
Made just about every bird bath that you could ever make. And I got to the stage where I was absolutely fed up with them for a long time. But now I don't make so many of them. I don't mind just making the ordinary ones again. Ordinary sort of rustic one. When you do have to put the tool marks on it, like this punching here, you have to do it in a way that it will look effective. You can't just punch it all off willy-nilly. So it's just putting the punches in position that you leave it, leaving a nice sort of pretty pattern really, so it looks effective. This bowl is in English ash, a timber much used by Dorset craftsmen for tool handles and very much favoured by wheelwrights for the parts of carts. Come with me to my workshop and I'll show you how to make a bowl like this. With wood turning, you're learning all the time. You can go on courses to learn the technique, but I'm purely self-taught. I'm going to show you how I made this bowl, which is in English ash. This is a comparable piece of timber, and we'll do the outside and the base first, and then reverse it to do the inside of the bowl.
The history of the buttons is very interesting. It started in about 1622 with a man called Abraham Case, who set up making buttons, and the first ones he made were the high tops, and they soon became popular in the courts in London. And then a more flattened version called a Dorset knob was made, and this was the same technique, and they're made on a little disc of sheep's horn with padded muslin and then embroidered afterwards. A softer button was needed for the children's clothes, and so bird's eyes were invented. These have got pearls in the middle, but of course they didn't to start with have pearls. They were just a round, soft button. Over the years, I have been asked to make several buttons for films. They only want usually just one costume or perhaps two, because film companies like to be very authentic with what they have done. I was asked to do some for the first Harry Potter film, which was quite exciting. So they said, could I do a rush job and do some for one of the ghosts in the film? So I did. I had to work very hard because the costume had 110 buttons on one costume. It was made in silk with very special braid, and the buttons had to be designed specially. And they had to be made in 5 days and sent overnight to be done so that they could get on with the costume.
Okay, that's it now, we're finished. That's another satisfied customer. They'll be back in about 8 weeks' time and have another set of shoes on. If they get on and ride it as they should do, they should be absolutely wore out, so they'll be another satisfied customer.
Crafts have always been a way of life in Dorset. If you want to be rich, you'd never take this line of business. You have to be prepared to work long hours. You have to be dedicated and be prepared once again to work in all winds and weather. Certain crafts, such as the Hurdlemaker and the Thatcher, are under pressure at all times due to the increased cost of reed or the renting of the land that the hazelcocks grow on. Each craft, there are people looking to see if they can undercut the price or by using inferior materials so that they can get into the market. Consider all the years the properties have been thatched. Farmers have been using hurdles. It proves there's only one way to make anything, and that is the proper way with a Dorset craftsman.